Good evening. A very warm welcome to this, the medical, psychosocial, and economic impact of COVID-19 in India. We are really and really grateful that we got Dr. Varma as our guest, and as well as Srimati Joyashil Ghosh. Dr. Varma, ex-HOD, internal medicine, and he was a dean at PGI Chandigarh last 42 and a half years, and currently associated with Fortis group of hospitals. And Srimati Joyashil Ghosh, actor and dancer, and a very, very famous personality. Welcome to this show. And Dr. Baidyanath from CAV, he is the chief. And I request Dr. Baidyanath to welcome our guest today and start the show with your questions, and Jayati is here, so she can also ask the questions. Welcome, Dr. Varma and Jayati.
Thank you.
Thank you. Welcome, Doctor.
So I welcome Jayati because she's now become part of CAV family, and I also welcome Dr. Varma. He is the HOD of internal medicine from PGI Chandigarh, so he's the biggest name in medicine we could have got, so we are very thrilled today. You know, this is the most important.
Now, I'm going to ask first time to a doctor like this, and thanks to CAV for giving me this opportunity. Well, I have written some questions with the help of Dr. Baidyanath also. Doctor, if you could please explain, very starting question, it's very normal question, but we should start because general public should know that way. If you could please explain what is COVID-19 or coronavirus for common people? It's a very simple question, but I think people, if you see this, they should get some knowledge about this virus, which is affecting us so much.
Thank you for your question. Basically, COVID-19 is a virus that belongs to corona group of viruses. This is a new virus because it is slightly different from the previous viruses that infected humans or others. And this virus, in the earlier times, we had two kinds of epidemics, that is SARS or severe acute respiratory syndrome in early 2000, and then Middle East respiratory syndrome. But this one is slightly different as compared to those, and it is turning out to be different in terms of its infectivity, as well as the rate at which spreading to other people. So they were contained much earlier, and we in the world now have a situation where we are getting much larger number of people affected all over the world, and that WHO is now calling it a pandemic.
Okay, so it is affecting so much more what we all are facing. Basically, it's infection level is too much. We have to be so much, conscious about our hygiene, our cleaning, and disinfection and all. So why so much we have to do? What kind of action, the activities of this virus is doing so much vigorously that we can't, we are not able to handle? What's the symptoms of this?
What are the symptoms? She's asking, what are the symptoms of
symptoms of this?
Yeah.
So once somebody gets infected with coronavirus and it is infected through personal contact with a patient who's already having it, or through the droplets, or those droplets also be on mites, and it could come from there. So basically, since the virus particles, they come out in either cough or sneeze, and they tend to settle on the surfaces, on the clothes, on the hands, and once we touch those areas, and then we touch our either mouth or nose or eyes, that gains entry into our body. Once it gains entry into the body, then after some time, it manifests with various disease manifestations or symptoms. In general, it is said that it takes about 7 days for the symptoms to appear. Our number of days is around 4.2. But around 7 days, most people would become symptomatic. Majority of people have very, very mild symptoms, And those symptoms are that of cough, thumb fever, body aches, occasional sneezing, which is much less as compared to patients who have influenza virus infection. But you cannot really differentiate this virus from other viral illnesses in terms of the symptoms that are occurring. So the epidemiological contact is something that is important in this setting. And initially we said anybody who's coming from outside, say for example from Wuhan or from China traveling, then develops these symptoms, was more likely to have this as compared to other kind of viral infections. Now, after some days of infection in majority of people, it would settle down. But in about 10 to 15% of patients, the symptoms may become more, they might become aggravated, they might start developing shortness of breath, and then they might need hospitalization. So the serious patients are those who start developing shortness of breath, and then they need respiratory, and they are very sick. They are the ones who actually ultimately might lose their life to this virus.
So I have some friends. I'm just asking.
Yeah,
I have one friend in London. She has infected by this, but London process is different. So she's in home only. She's at home and she's not taking any medicines, but she's just taking rest more. She says that she needs to take more rest, and she's a yoga teacher also, so she's doing the yogas of breathing and all. So slowly she's improving. So it's good. Some young girls, many young, she's like 40, 42, she's improving. But there is some patients who has the infection, but we don't know he or she has that infection of virus. There's no symptoms. So nowadays I'm hearing the asymptomatic patients are more nowadays. So we don't know that patient doesn't know about this. So how to tackle this kind of scenario?
So when you say asymptomatic, they could be either purely asymptomatic, or there could be mild symptoms that we tend to ignore many times. So if you get a sneeze or a cough, you might actually just pass it off as a normal phenomena. Not really feel that you are really suffering from it. But whereas you might be carrying the virus and you might actually give it to others. So in general, the initial principles were that if you have a history of exposure to somebody, then you would be in isolation for a certain period of time. The time that was 14 days. And if you did not develop any symptoms during that time, nothing would be done. But if you developed any symptoms, then a test would be done. And if you are positive, then you would actually be kept in isolation till you have completely recovered and the test is negative at least twice.
Okay, like that. Thank you, doctor. Yeah, that's enough.
Now, I do have a question to Dr. Verma. Sir, I have a more technical question for you. That is about testing and contact tracing. Now, there has been a very big political debate across India that some states are testing well, some states are not testing well. Now, on behalf of CAB, we have studied the Korean model very thoroughly, and we believe that the Korean model of contact tracing is a good one. Now, if you could explain to us what is the ideal testing, surveillance, and contact tracing required in a case like COVID-19?
If you had everything in place and if you did not have the problems of a very large country, then ideal would be that you should be able to trace every contact that a patient has been with, a COVID positive patient, in the last 14 days, right? That means that a very thorough history taking and then visiting those people and seeing them or examining them and testing them. However, given the current situation, you require a very large manpower to actually do it. But contact tracing in the initial phase is the most important thing to contain infection like this. Because if you contact trace, if you can find people, then you can quarantine them, you can test them, and then you can let them go into the infection. Korea is a relatively small country. It's easier for them to do contact tracing compared to our country. And we also have a problem of the kind of operation. So there are issues. So contact tracing in the initial case will be the best thing.
Sir, I have a specific question here. And the specific question is that South Korea has developed a model by which they have taken the phones of the cases and using the signal of the phone, they have got the contact. For example, this sensor, you can look at my phone, this gives a signal. Right, now suppose I am a case and Joyadi is a contact. Now my phone signal can be tracked to her phone signal. Korea has basically tracked the mobile phone signal as they have collected all the contacts very easily. They haven't done door-to-door. They haven't relied on history. They have used technology. Do you think such a model can be implemented in India? Because we don't have technology implementation currently. We are lagging behind. What is your view on that?
I think we can actually think about these models with the kind of penetration of the telephones in the in the Indian population, but I am not really very sure whether we have actually tried to do it in our context. I can see that new app that Government of India is actually putting up, the Arogya thing, and that actually has a way to contact people wherever they go. So they will place them everywhere. But we haven't actually used individual telephones as yet. I don't think that I'm really the right person to say, because it would require collating a large data and then actually analyzing it and acting upon it. So showing it for 135 million people, or not 135 million, actually 135 crore people.
So why don't we collaborate with the South Korean government? The South Korean government has got technology, or the government of Japan has got technology. So why can't we collaborate with them? What is your view on this? And this is a question to both Dr. Verma and Joyadi. Open-ended question to both.
Our country actually has enough people who work in the field of IT, and they can actually develop a model and actually work on it. I don't think that you really have to go to Korea for this. This is a model that is based upon artificial intelligence, and that is possible by our own people.
I just want to mention something. I just want to mention something. There is some noise. I don't know whose phone calls. Like there is a big sound. Actually, your voice is cracking or something like. Happening, I don't know, because I can't hear you properly. I think Dr. Verma.
Okay.
Yes, I think so. Sometimes the sound is coming that crows are there, I think, somewhere.
So I have a question. Yeah. One minute. I have a question.
Yes, follow.
Joyadi, you know, the South Korean government, you know, I discussed the South Korean model with you the other day. Now, South Korean government has used a lot of technology. One technology, I've told you that they were using the mobile phone of the case. And using the signal of the mobile phone of the case, they are getting all the carriers very quickly. Secondly, South Korean government has developed apps which allow people to understand the areas where infection is there, the clusters and the hotspots, so you can avoid them. And South Korean government has used more technology like social media, looking at cameras to find the contacts very fast. So they have a lot of technology. We have done papers on that. Now, CAB believes that Indian government can collaborate with South Korea and other governments. That is not happening. What is your view as a citizen of this country?
That even China,
see, frankly,
China artificial intelligence and telephones to contact those people.
But that's not happening. That is not happening.
No, China.
It is not happening.
There also. Yeah.
That's what happened in India. For example, in Rajasthan, they did door-to-door tracing. But the fact that we can use social media and phones to track all the cases and the carriers, contacts, we're not using that. So this is a very serious issue. perhaps we have IT in Bangalore, but if Kotians have a technology in place which is very effective, I don't understand what is the harm in collaborating with them, because we've done it before. We have worked.
No, see, what you are saying,
yes,
I can say a little bit, but I don't know that much. But yeah, if it's helping, we are seeing a result, then we should, according to as a citizen, I feel that we should follow that. If we are seeing there's a result. But yeah, now there's a lot of things from the government to inner government, how they are going to decide and all. As we know, Chinese test kits are not result. They're not giving a correct results.
Faulty kits.
So one should, one can follow this South Korea thing. And now it's completely dependent on the governments and all the states. If they all talk together, because they're going to have a meeting very soon in Tuesday, I think. If they have, they give a proposal about that and they can talk about that. There should be one way we can take out by talking to each other. So I think the solution will come like that. I can just hope for that.
Yeah, yeah, surely. I think it's for us to.
Okay.
Sorry. So it's for us to suggest things, and I mean, we can suggest it to some other people also. But I'm sure that, like you, many other people might have suggested people. Whether they have looked at the feasibility, whether they have really contacted people. But I think a noise can be made a number of times till it is heard.
Sir, I have another question, which is a very medical question. What is your view? Various countries are making and working vaccines right now. Like Oxford started the human trial of vaccines. And I think there is a group in USA which is working on a DNA vaccine. So I have the first question to you, sir. How much time do you think we'll get a vaccine? And I also have a question that, you know, what kind of vaccine is required in this case? The second question is, how much time we require to develop drugs for COVID and what kind of drugs are required? So two specific questions, Dr. Verma. One is vaccine, second is drugs.
So currently, I don't think that we have anything effective. The Oxford vaccination trial has started yesterday. And it will take us at least 6 to 8 months for us to know the initial results. Now, there are several other people who are working in this particular field, and Government of India has also set up a task force for development of vaccine. The problem with vaccines is predominantly is that when we give something and antibodies are produced, we need to know that these antibodies are protective and not harmful. We also know that for the earlier coronavirus, when a vaccination was produced, at that particular time, the antibodies actually increase the cytotoxicity. So the illness actually increased, what you call antibody dependent cytotoxicity. Mm-hmm. So what we need to know is that produce antibodies and they produce protective antibodies. And that we will get to know after the initial trials. Then only we will be able to use these vaccines. And I don't think that there is a vaccine in sight, at least for general public use, before 2021.
Now, why do you think that? Why do you say so? Why do you say so? Why do you think
that? Because that is the time that it will take us to actually collect the evidence, look at whether it makes a difference or it makes, and it does no harm. Okay, that is the first. So it will take us that much of time to first experiment, then analyze the data, and then come up with clear indications. A lot of things take time to develop, and then you need to have a you need to validate these. Without that, you can't really use them in general public. Now, coming to your other question of drugs, right? So we say about 85% of people actually get better, so they require only good supportive care, as you were saying, rest, good food, some paracetamol to relieve the symptoms, steam inhalation, and stay away from other people so that the disease does not spread to others.
Yeah.
Only a smaller number of people who develop serious illness. That is a major question for us. Why is it that some people develop a severe disease whereas others do not? We do not have clear answers. But we know that certain people are at greater risk, for example, elderly. For example, people with coexisting diseases like diabetes or hypertension or heart disease. That they end up having more severe disease or they end up losing their lives to this virus, and that is where most of the consequences are. We must also realize that if we go on to ventilators, only about 1/3 of them come out of ventilators. What is the stage at which...
Sir, you need to speak louder. Louder. Sir, you need to speak louder.
The noise is coming from somewhere else because I'm also hearing it. Okay. I will just bring it near.
Yeah, it's fine, sir.
Yeah, there is a sound of a crow somewhere. I don't know.
Yeah, it's in my house.
Okay.
I'll just close my door. I'll just close my door.
I can hear it. Okay. Right. So, now the issues are there any drugs that would actually change the course of this illness? And there were several that people have tried over a period of time, and none of them actually, I mean, there was a lot of hype about these drugs, but there is no clear data about these drugs. The first was hydroxychloroquine. So there were two studies and they said that hydroxychloroquine would work. But now we have data which suggests that it possibly does not work from another study. So we'll have to just see these data over a period of time and then see what happens, right? There is a data on an anti-parasitic drug called ivermectin. But all these are data in the lab where it inhibits the growth of the virus, but we really do not know what it does in the population. So what are people doing there? They are looking at complications that tend to occur in severely sick patients and try to tide over those complications. For example, there are some coagulation abnormalities that people are finding. So if you find them, you might treat them specifically for those things. But as of now, I do not, and the antiviral remdesivir, there were some reports which suggested that it works, but now we have another study which said that it may not be that effective. Maybe combination of drugs, as was suggested initially in Jaipur by Jaipur doctors, that is anti-HIV drugs with chloroquine, with azithromycin. But all these will have to be tested. And we have to show a consistent effect rather than one-off effect. In a disease in which, say, 85% of the people improve on their own, it's very difficult for you to say superiority of one kind of treatment. And that's why, as of now, we do not have any proven treatment for this disease. So as of now, supportive care, social distancing for avoiding spread, and then treating those who are seriously sick in hospital conditions.
So, मैं एक सवाल, डॉक्टर वेदनंद के एक सवाल
करूँगा।
तो फिर अगर वैक्सीन तो अभी टाइम आपने जैसे बता 2021 तक लगेगा शायद, और अगर ड्रग्स का भी ऐसा हालत है, तो हम जो जो लोग हैं, हम लोग फिर कैसे, मतलब वही सोशल डिस्टेंसिंग और उस हिसाब से ही लाइफ जीना है या लॉकडाउन में ही जीना है, जिंदगी क्या है फिर, मतलब हम तो अटक गए, मतलब हम क्रिएटिविटी भी कुछ कर नहीं पा रहे, मॉनेटरी प्रॉब्लम बहुत ज्यादा हो रहा है, तो आप बताइए इसका सोल्यूशन, हम क्या ऐसे ही जिंदगी चलाना है, हमें क्या करेंगे फिर हम?
तो मैं आपकी बात समझता हूँ, बट यू मस्ट अंडरस्टैंड दैट फॉर मेनी वायरल इलनेसेस एक्चुअली वी डू नॉट हैव एनी मेडिकेशन. So if you have severe influenza, what do you do? You take drugs to control the symptoms.
Control, yeah.
And hope that the your body would get over it and you'll get better. A small number of patients there also develop pneumonia. A small number of patients there also develop other complications. And there are issues that tend to occur in those individuals. But in majority of the people, we are saying that about 90, in India, the death rate is about 3%, right? So 97% of the people would get better eventually. So one thing is that there is a fear, and that fear should go away. That is the first thing. things can go wrong, but in majority of the people, things would not go wrong most likely. But what can we do? So the next thing is that if we cannot treat the disease or we cannot cure it, then you tend to use things to ameliorate symptoms. And in an infectious disease, you tend to take measures so that this disease does not spread further, right? And we will have to be part of that. We are most likely going the way people in England and Sweden thought that way, that someday we will develop what is called herd immunity, and that the disease will die down on its own. But it will take time for herd immunity. With the kind of infectiousness that this disease has, about 50% of the population will have to be infected before herd immunity makes its appearance. But people are using the so-called immunity or the immunological response for treating severely sick patients. So there are now trials for serum, which is obtained from people who have completely recovered, to treat seriously sick patients and see if their symptoms actually get better or if they come out of it. Some initial interesting results, but I do not think that we have, as of now, means to say that everyone should receive it.
So why do you think that developing a medicine or vaccine to a viral illness is so difficult in comparison to a bacterial infection? Why? What is your opinion?
So these are very small organisms, either an RNA or a DNA. And it has been a bit difficult in most of these circumstances. We have now, for several illnesses, treatments available when we know what is the target, right? So I think we would be, the scientists would be working on it, and there would be targets which would be available. But the point that I'm trying to make is that as of now, we do not have anything. People are working on several issues. Maybe combination of drugs would work here, but we will have to have good trials to actually show us that there is evidence for their use. For example, when chloroquine and azithromycin was put up by people in France, it was said to be very, very helpful in their setup, right? Mm. The current study about which the things have come in NEJM, it actually suggests that it was harmful in these individuals.
Okay.
There are studies which are going on for enhancing immunity. Mm. And Australia is doing a study on BCG vaccination in their healthcare workers. So we thought that we have already BCG vaccinated people, so maybe that we would have less of it.
Yeah,
but I don't think there is enough data as of now to say so.
So that was my next question, what you just now said. Sir, my question was that do you think that Indians are less susceptible to this illness because we are vaccinated with BCG, and also because India is a malaria endemic zone, there are reports, do you think we are less susceptible or protected anyway? So two medical questions again. One is on BCGs, the second being the malaria endemic zone, does it give us protections?
So both are the hypotheses which are running around, and these are so far hypotheses. It is possible that there may be a difference, but the current rate of increase in our country, I think we'll just have to watch it and then see what happens. There is an interesting paper from Olin Institute of Medical Sciences by Dr. Goswami, where they have talked about BCG vaccination in the world and the COVID virus infection. Mm. And something very interesting that they brought out is that countries where TB has been eradicated, their BCG was protected. Mm. But in other, for example, in a setting like ours, they aren't really very sure that this would be.
Okay.
About the malaria hypothesis, again, I think if you look at the data, it's interesting in the sense that the number of cases are much less in countries where malaria was endemic. But I'm not really very sure whether it's only because of the fact that there was an endemic malaria and there are no other factors, including even the kind of population movement that tends to take place in countries where it is being very rapidly spreading compared to those countries. So I think that there might be other factors also, and we need to look that up. And even if it is so, I think we can only say that it might help us to some extent. But if we have R0 of the kind that we have is doubling at 9 days, given the population density of our country, we are still looking at large numbers.
Sir, is there any genetic protection to COVID-19? Again, this is a very medical question, but it's very relevant.
So the only data that I know of predominantly is that it has been said that in US, the US blacks are at greater risk, and they are at, attributing it to ACE2 gene polymorphism. If you know the spike protein of the coronavirus, that gains entry to the ACE2 receptor on the endothelial cells of the respiratory tract.
And they the angiotensin 2 receptor, sir, is the angiotensin 2 receptor.
Angiotensin converting enzyme 2, ACE2. So, but we really do not know whether we have the same we have the same polymorphism or we have a protective polymorphism for the time being. The other controversy with ACE2 was if ACE2 inhibition would help, but the ACE2 inhibitors that we use are ACE1 inhibitors and not 2 inhibitors, and therefore that may or may not actually have any effect at all.
Yes. So, sir, three things very important. You said that perhaps malaria and TB vaccination may have a protective role, but you're just keeping it as a probability. And secondly, blacks have a greater tendency at infection and mortality because of the polymorphism.